أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وحبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد
اللهم صل على محمد
صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين بتراب مقدمه الفداء. Respected scholars, elderly brothers and sisters, young and old, one and old, Assalamu alaikum jami'an wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Just in case you haven't heard about me, I'm an adopted Khoja Sheikh, as I was telling the brothers earlier today. Since my first experience with the Khoja community of the Jamaat in Sydney back in 1994, when I was invited for the first time to deliver series of talks on the occasion of Muharram for the Ashari Muharram, there was a talk that how come Sheikh Mansour is invited to recite for the Khoja community. And some they said maybe we have Iranian Khoja as well. Now here you go, this is Iranian Khoja. Don't think that there is no Iranian Khoja. But I'm an Iranian Khoja who doesn't speak Gujarati and doesn't speak Urdu as well. Speaks English, Farsi and Arabic only. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. This was only a brief introduction and to break the ice, as we say. Alhamdulillah, الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله. We cannot thank the Almighty God enough for the blessing of being Muslim, blessing of being mu'min, and the lovers and the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, and the blessing of being the honorable guest of the Almighty God in the month that belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The month that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself, he says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن, is the month in which the Holy Quran is revealed. The month that we are all invited by the blessing of God at the invited in this month at his divine banquet. A month full with spirituality. Inshallah, the theme of my talks in the coming months, all the way through until the end of the month of Ramadan, will be about the spirituality of the month of Ramadan and how we can uplift, inshallah, our spirituality. And at the same time, on special occasions that we have, such as tonight and tomorrow night, the occasion of the birth anniversary of Imam Hassan al-Mushtaba alayhi salam. Sallu ala Muhammad wa
ala Muhammad.
As well as the occasion of the martyrdom anniversary of Amir al-Mu'minin Imam Ali alayhi salam. I will be inshallah touching and talking about those special occasions. Tonight, allow me to make it more of the orientation and preparation for the main analysis of some aspects of the life of Imam Hassan al-Mushtaba alayhi salam that is very essential for us as the lovers and the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, inshallah, to know about it. The reason that I say allow me inshallah to make it only an orientation because almost it had taken me 24 hours to make it to come here. And I'm talking to you and my brain is asleep. So if you see that I'm talking nonsense, it's just because I'm dreaming perhaps. And I'm talking to you. Inshallah, this... No, it's not the microphone, it's the speaker, I know that. It will be alright. As I start the engine, inshallah, I take off and then my voice gets stronger. You're telling me how close it. The thing is that if I get too close to these microphones, I may swallow them. Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam, brothers and sisters, according to all historians, there is no dispute that he was born 3 years after the migration of the Holy Prophet of Islam to Medina on the 15th, which means in the middle of the month of Ramadan of that year, 3 years after the migration. Because being the very first grandson of the Prophet, his birth is well registered in the history. Likewise, when it comes to the martyrdom and the date of the martyrdom of Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam, it is also well registered historically. Unfortunately, our dear Imam did not live in this world long under the age of 50, and to be more precise, he was almost 47 years when he was poisoned to death. When we look at the lifestyle of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, and mind you that whatever we say about the Holy Prophet of Islam, about the characteristics of the Holy Prophet of Islam, about the virtues of the Holy Prophet of Islam, applies, and we believe the same for the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, as his pure offspring and the generation of the Prophet. With the exception of course, prophecy. Or, as we said, prophethood. Astaghfirullah, of course, we believe that prophethood ceased to continue with the Prophet of Islam. There is no more prophet to come. But in terms of the akhlaq, the virtues, and as the Prophet himself, he says that ana adibullah wa aliyun adibi, I have been disciplined by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Ali ibn Abi Talib has been disciplined by me. In terms of the knowledge also, whatever of the knowledge that we prove for the Prophet of Islam, if he is the city of the knowledge, Ali ibn Abi Talib, Imam Ali is the gate to that knowledge. And whatever we prove for Imam Ali, we prove it for Imam Hassan and all the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, because they are Noor-e Wahid. There is no distinction between them. Now, speaking of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, there are two aspects or two dimensions, two angles from which we can study the lifestyle and the biography of the Imams. One aspect is common, talking about the common characteristics of all the Imams of Ahlul Bayt. All of them enjoyed it, each and every one of them. That I refer to as the common characteristics of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt. In that respect, there is no difference between Imam Hassan, Imam Zainul Abidin, Imam Sadiq, and any of them. All the same. Here, talking about the common characteristics, there are again two sides we can look at it. One is what we call it the side of Yaler Rab. It means in terms of the relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As if there is no human, nothing else on earth existing. If it was only Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam and the Almighty God, hypothetically speaking, this is what we call it talking and learning the personality of Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam in terms of his relation with God. In that, the very first common character of Imam Hassan and all the Ahlul Bayt is when it comes to their knowledge. The knowledge of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, brothers and sisters, and inshallah by the grace of God, we have so many examples that in the coming nights we'll learn more about it, and inshallah we'll acknowledge it, is that their knowledge is not acquired knowledge. Acquired knowledge means the knowledge that, like you and I, ordinary people, we have to go to school, kneel before a teacher, study books, through the hardship process of learning, learn something, memorize it, and now we say we learn. Alright? Unless I had gone to Jose and studied, I didn't know about it. I was not born like this, but I know all of us are like this. The Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, they didn't need to go through the process of learning to acquire, to gain their knowledge. In so much as the Prophet of Islam sallallahu alayhi wa sallam didn't need to go to any school to learn what he had learned by revelation, is the kind of the knowledge that they have had, and we have a proof in the Quran for that in Surah Al-Kahf, وَعَلَّمْنَاهُ مِنْ لَدُنَّا عِلْمًا. This is what we call it, ilmi ladunni. یعنی دو المایتی گاد هست نالج العلم و نورون یقدفه الله فی قلب من یشا. نالج is a نور. The reality of knowledge, not the terminologies, is a nur that God will cast into the heart of whoever He wills. The best level of it, the highest, the perfect level of it, is granted to Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. As much as you and I get connected to that source of nur that is sent to us through Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, we can be illuminated as well. In as much as the more you stay towards the nur, your face will be shining. The more we turn away from it, the more will be dark. So the knowledge of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam is not an acquired knowledge. And that's why you see that whether the Imam is 5 years old or 50 years old, there's no such difference for them. Here, an answer to one of the very critical questions that how come a 6-year-old boy becomes my Imam? Talking about, for example, Imam Hadi alayhi salam will be answered. And we have a proof in the Quran for it that Prophet Isa alayhi salam or Prophet Yahya, when they were in the cradle, this is the Quran, when they were in the cradle, Prophet Isa says that Ja'alani Nabiya, God has made me already a prophet. When we say this, some people they assume that, well, then this is determinism. No, there is determinism and there is free will at the same time. Each and every one of us, brothers and sisters, we are gifted. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gifted all humanity. The gift that He has given to you, different maybe from me, different from the third person, just like the talents. You see that different people have different talents? What happens is that that talent through your life, you can develop it. You can activate it. But if you have, for example, a calligraphy talent, if you have engineering talent, that talent is there, genetically you have it. What happens is that you activate it through your life. You develop it through your life. This is just an example that I'm giving, that the Imams of Ahlul Bayt and Muslim, yes, are born like that. From birth to death, protected by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the knowledge also is there. It's not just they had to go learn it somewhere. This is one. Second, when it comes to their relation with God in terms of their servitude, in terms of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, all historians, friends and foes are unanimous. Any of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, and inshallah I will bring you the quotations from them, their testimonies. Any of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam, you study their biography, they all acknowledge that, talking for example Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam, كَانَ أَعْبَدَ النَّاسِ فِي زَمَانِ. No one had worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam at his time. Because the purpose of the creation of man and the jinn, as Quran says, مَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسِ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ, is to worship the Imam as the leader of the humanity, the leader of the world. In fact, he has to be on the peak of the level of the worshiping acts. And that's why, for example, they narrate that Imam Hassan Mujtaba, that was him, himself, naturally. Every time he comes to the mosque, like I came to the mosque tonight, all of us, we came to this house of God tonight. How did we enter? If it was Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam, at the entrance door, he was stopping, he used to stop there shivering. His face goes pale. Ilahi dhaifuka bibabik ya Muhsin ad ataka al-musi. And Imam is in tears. Talking about Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam, as if astaghfirullah, a very sinful criminal who is brought to the judge, how he's shivering. That is the attitude of Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam, going to the mosque to pray. He is entering the mosque and he is in tears. One of his servants comes and says, Ya Abna Rasulullah, you are the Imam of this community. Your father, your mother, you are coming from such a noble family, people are looking at you, you are in tears. Imam says, Da'ani, leave me and people. I'm with my Lord, you are talking to me about people's attention to me. I don't see them, I'm oblivious of the world.
I'm in the house of the King of the Kings. I'm in the presence of God. Now you're telling me that people are looking at me? When you're under the sun and you can see the rays, the strong rays of the sun, would you notice of a candle? Doesn't the light of a candle exist? That's why when it comes to their worshipping, they were so much in the presence of God. So much so that they were oblivious of the entire world. Again, that goes back to their knowledge, of course. Because of the kind of the knowledge, the profound knowledge that they had about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Hassan Mujtaba, and this is what that I'm telling you, applies, as I told, to all the Imams of Ahlul Bayt. And we're talking at this level still about the common characteristics of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. This is Yalil Rab, in terms of the relation with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the knowledge about God, worshipping of God. There is another facet to their personality, and that is when it comes to their social relation. Unfortunately, there is a misconception that we think that if I'm a spiritual person, I cannot be humorous, I cannot have any social role, I cannot have any, like, I'm not expected to have a sociable person. This man is very, mashallah, spiritual. He's an arif, frown and not, you know, dealing with any. On the contrary, look who can be more arif than Imam Ali alayhi salam. Imam al-Urafa. You know, one of the comments that they had on Imam Ali alayhi salam during that mischief of the Khilafah that they made against Imam, they said, because he's humorous, fihi du'aba, he's got sense of humor. How can a man who has got sense of humor be the Imam? Allahu Akbar. Imam Ali alayhi salam says, if that's the case, then the Prophet should not be in that position. He had more sense of humor than me. Yes, I'm humorous, but I don't say anything that God would not be pleased with. Alright? The Imams of Ahlul Bayt, definitely they were sociable. When it comes to social life, down to earth. If nobody knew them, they didn't know whether this is an Imam of Ahlul Bayt, they would assume that he's an ordinary person. So much down to earth in terms of their personality. In terms of caring and sharing, I'm mentioning these headings and passing through quickly, so that telling you that the ayah of the Quran that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنًا. In the lifestyle of the Prophet, there is a role model for you. In the lifestyle of Imam Hassan alayhi salam also, and all the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, these are role models. It's not just for us to read, learn, hear, wow, get excited. No, Sheikh Mansour, God is telling you to learn these things so that you see how much of it you can practice. As long as, inshallah, we are on the same line. We cannot reach them, but be in the same line. When it comes to caring and sharing, and I put the question forward to you and myself, very honestly, in the house of God, if we have money that we have covered our debts, no more debt and everything that we want, we have done it. What would be the next project that you have? Well, my children. What next? Well, offspring. Well, trust, making a trust fund. Everything rotates around me, myself and I. This triangle of me, myself and I. This is again idol worshipping that I cannot come out of, me, myself and I. The Imams of Ahlul Bayt as our leaders and our role models were not like this. They were looking for an opportunity to have some money to give it for the sake of God. That was their hobby. They would enjoy it. They would enjoy it. But Ya Rasulullah, we don't have anything else left. I told you, I'm giving you and myself the highest example so that at least we go to the same line. I'm not saying to be like that. We cannot. A man comes to Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam complaining about his poverty. And the Imam is asking his treasurer, how much do we have? In those days they used to keep their money, they didn't have notes. It was a coin, dirham and dinar in a bag, money bag they call it. He says, like, for example, we have that money bag left. The Imam says, give it to him. He says, but Ya Rasulullah, nothing is left. Like, imagine that all the money you have in your account, you write a check and give it out.
to a needy person.
There was a spot, nothing is left. Your accountant is always very careful about you. You know, your business is in the hand of your accountant. Say nothing is left.
The Imam says that whatever God is providing, God is providing. As He provided before, He will provide. This man is in need of this money, give it to him. Allah Kareem.
Why Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba is known as Kareem Ahlul Bayt? Kareem has two meanings, and I mentioned both of them and examples and applications about the love of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. Kareem, one meaning of Kareem means generous. The one who is really generous in the real sense of it. A generous person is the one that enjoys giving. You don't have to go beg him to give. He enjoys giving. Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam was like this. Historians, friends and foes, they have mentioned Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam at least in his life, short lifetime, I told you, 47 years old, he lived in this world. In his lifetime, two or three times, whatever he earned and he made, half it, half to the poor and needy, half I keep it. They say he was so particular that historians have maybe exaggerated. They say that when he was harming, he was really harming all his estate. Even a pair of shoes, one goes this side, one goes this side. This is just maybe, it sounds exaggeration to say that how particularly. And now when it comes to us to give 20 person, Sheikh, whoo! My leader was harming his wealth, his entire estate. Two or three times. Imagine that you have a business, running a company business, reach a certain amount of money, you say, all right, now, harvey. Again, work hard, again, goes up, harvey. This is Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba. One meaning of Kareem, therefore, is generosity. Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba was really generous in the sense of it. The second meaning of Kareem is the one who forgives. Kareem means generous because generosity sometimes is by giving money, sometimes is by closing your eyes, like as if I didn't notice. Someone insulted you and you were Kareem, yani you were so honorable that you don't bring yourself down to the level of that person to answer him back. You are an honorable person, you let go of it. Imam Hassan was Kareem also in that sense. A man from Sham, Damascus of those days, bombarded against Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba and Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, came to Medina. As soon as he saw the Imam, with no hesitation, he started swearing and insulting the Imam. When he finished, Imam Hassan looked at him and said, brother, from your accent I can tell you're Syrian and you're new in this town. Do you need accommodation, brother? Are you hungry? Would you mind being my guest of honor tonight? Really, let's put ourselves in his shoes. Someone comes insulting and the head of the community I'm talking about, a blink is enough to get rid of him. And look at how he's treating him. And that man, once he noticed who the Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam was, he says, Allahu a'lam haythu yaj'alu risalata. God knows where he had put that Imam at. With Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba, not the other side. The personality of the Imam. Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam, inshallah, we'll touch on it tonight. Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam was so forgiving that even his wife that poisoned him to death, Ja'ade, did not release her name. Even Imam Hussein comes and says, brother, who did that to you? Historians say that it didn't come out of the mouth of Imam Hassan. Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba never said it himself. He didn't introduce her. She confessed later on, but not Imam Hassan. Okay? So this is one aspect of the personality of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt. Inshallah, when I talk about Imam Ali alayhi salam, I'll give you examples of the life of Imam Ali. All the Imams, that common aspect applies to all of them. In Islamic mysticism, our urafa, they say there is no duplication in creation. What does it mean? There is no duplication in creation. If you say salawat, inshallah, I'll explain it to you.
Muhammad!
That means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because He is unique, His creation is also unique. Not two humans, not two birds, not two objects, not two kinds of creation in this world are identical. Even identical twins, medically they call them identical. Philosophically, there is no identical twins existing at all. If you ask the birds if possibly they could communicate with them and tell them that we humans, we look different or the same, they will tell you guys all look the same. In so much as when we look at the birds, we think that birds like, I don't know, any pigeons in Kenya, in Australia, or in Iran, in Europe, in America, they all look the same. Oh my friend, they look the same to you because of lack of knowledge. As zoologists, they tell you not two birds are the same. Excuse the example I gave you, I want to bring to the topic. The Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, as much as we say the Al-Nur al-Wahid, but each and every one of them, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has an exam sheet for every human that He has created. The exam sheet of Prophet Adam was different from his son, different from Ibrahim, different from Musa, as you read the history of the prophets. The same about the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. The exam sheet of Imam Hussein, you see, different from Imam Hassan, different from Imam Zain al-Abidin, isn't it? The same applies to you and I as well. In that aspect, you see different differences in the lifestyle of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. The test that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put Imam Hassan through, did not put Imam Hussein through, did not put Imam Zain al-Abidin through, and so forth. Now, one of the main personality or characteristics of Imam Hassan Mujtaba that makes him quite unique, distinguished from his family, is Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam was Ghareeb. Ghareeb, it means lonely. All the Imams were lonely. Imam Ali was lonely. I may say that there has not been anyone lonelier than Imam Zaman Jalallahu ta'ala farajahu sharif. Sallu ala Muhammad. A dear Imam that over a millennium he is in occultation and his community still is not ready for him to appear. If he has not appeared, it's because of us. So he is also Ghareeb. But Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam, his ghurba and loneliness is very distinguished. That I, with all respect, give a bit of comparison. And this is just an introduction to, inshallah, tomorrow night, talk about the accusations that were given to Imam Hassan Mujtaba to confirm his ghurba, his loneliness more, and clarification, inshallah, about it. Compare, for example, the ghurbat of Imam Hassan and Imam Hussein, these two brothers that there is only 6-7 months difference between them. We all say that Imam Hussein was mazloom and ghareeb. Of course he was mazloom and ghareeb. But subhanallah, brothers, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, at least he had 70, over 70 loyal companions, like Muslim ibn Usajjah, that he says, if they come, kill me, bear me through my ashes, bring me back to life again. Say, are you going to support Hussein and Ali? I say, of course. Kill me again. 70 times they do this to me, I will not forsake. I will not abandon my Imam. Imam Hassan Mujtaba didn't have such companions. Not only that, as inshallah tomorrow night I'll give you an example. Sadly, his own cousin betrayed him for money. His own cousin. Yes, Imam Hussein was mazloom and ghareeb. But Imam Hussein was not killed by his own wife. In the security of his own house, Imam Hussein had security. You know, no matter how much problems you have at home, if at home, like you have, inshallah, a spouse, wife, husband, that you can confide with him, how comfortable you feel. Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam even didn't have that comfort in the comfort zone that everybody would deserve to have. Not only that eventually he was killed in his own house, but by his own wife.
This is ghurbat, isn't it? Diplomat is loneliness. That there is a spy nested in his own house. This is the ghurbat of Imam Hassan Mujtaba. Imam Hassan compared him, for example, with Imam Zainul Abidin. Yes, after the tragedy of Karbala, the time of Imam Zainul Abidin, especially the first few years, were so tough for the Shia. So tough. That Imam Zainul Abidin says that with excuses they would behead us. After the tragedy, if they, that's what they did to the master, Imam Hussein, imagine what would happen to their followers. They raided Madinatul Nabi, the troops of Yazid. 3 days he had ordered his troops that Madinah is yours, enjoy it. I'm ashamed here to say the details of what they did in that city of the Prophet. Yet no historians have mentioned that ever they dared attacking the house of Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam. But not compared with the time of Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam. Imam Hassan Mujtaba repeatedly, he was unsuccessfully, but assassinated by his own companions, by his own soldiers, so much so that he comes to the mosque to lead the prayer, he had to wear the shield under his clothes to protect himself. Because there was no security, even his bodyguards were betraying him. This Imam is not Ghareeb. The one who is supposed to be the bodyguard of the Imam is assassinating the Imam. Again, tomorrow night, inshallah, we'll analyze it. Again, because of, as they call it, astaghfirullah, almighty dollar. Because of money. Money talks. They talk. We want to learn the history. I'm not just talking about the history. We speak about the history because we want to learn from people who used to look like you and I. We don't want to do this to our present Imam Imam al-Hujjah Jalallahu Farajhu Sharif. Two major accusations were given to the personality, to character assassinate. When they see that it's not easy to kill the person of the Imam, they try to kill the personality of the Imam. And you know that works. That's worse. You rather be killed 10 times. But your honor, your respect is maintained, huh? Your reputation is preserved. If someone, God forbid, tries to ruin your reputation, to maliciously speak against you so that your reputation is assassinated, that's worse. We call it the character assassination. One is with regards to, they say that Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam was Rajul Mitlaq. Mitlaq is the one who marries, divorces. Sadly, Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam, Yabna Rasulallah, our dear Imam was even ghareeb among his followers, and may I dare say that some of our, yani, with all respect, some of our naive scholars, they just quoted what the enemies have said without analyzing the source of it. That's why today in our authentic books of hadith, supposedly authentic, that narrated by someone who is trustworthy, yani he's not, when you say trustworthy, yani this person is not a liar. But yes, he's not a liar, but he was naive. You've come across these people. He's not a bad person, but he's naive. He narrated something that came from our enemies, was fabricated by the enemies of Ahlul Bayt, what he's narrated. Today we have it in our authentic books, and therefore the general public should say, but Shaykh, this hadith is in Kitab al-Kafi, for example. How come? And the sanad is correct. Yes, brother. That's why I say Imam Hassan is so ghareeb. So ghareeb. That even some of our scholars, they narrated and they said, yes, Imam Hassan was mitlaq. Mitlaq means that the one that they say he married over 250, 300 women and kept divorcing them. That people, they went to complain to Imam Ali and say that what your son is doing. And some people, they say that, well, he's the grandson of the Prophet. It doesn't matter. Let him marry as many as our daughters he want. And some naive narrators, they said, yeah, they thought that they were talking about the virtues of Ahlul Bayt. Yes, so what? He's the grandson of the brother. Where is your common sense? The Prophet has cursed the one who is mitlaq, the one who marries and divorces, marries and divorces, marries and divorces. Is it possible to say that the Prophet has cares? Astaghfirullah. Then what are you narrating? This is that we said that Imam Hassan was ghareeb, even among our narrators. You see the ghurbat of Imam Hassan, inshallah. This is one aspect. Another aspect that inshallah tomorrow we'll elaborate and analyze and learn from it is when it comes to the issue of the peace treaty with Muawiyah. That again, they accused Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam, fabricated something. Look, as if Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam was bribed, he took some money. I said, okay, I'll give the Khilafah to Muawiyah. Inshallah, that one, we want to analyze it and especially learn from it. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Tomorrow night is the actual night of the birth anniversary of Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam. Therefore, because it's a happy occasion, and as we are instructed by the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, we should be happy in their happiness and sad in their sadness. Tomorrow night I won't finish with the Zikr Musibat and Majlis. But other than that, inshallah, every night we'll have a few minutes of Majlis to bless our gathering, inshallah, and please the heart of Imam Zaman Ajallah Farajul Sharif. Tonight, let me tell you again, one of the misconceptions or mistakes about the life of Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam, that they misquote the Imam and narrate that Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam had said or misinterpreted it. That Imam Hassan Mujtaba, of course, was poisoned, as I said, by his wife. And he said that the pieces of my liver is coming out. I'm vomiting pieces of my liver. We all know that it's impossible for the liver to come to the stomach. If you have a little bit of biology knowledge, impossible for the liver to come to the stomach for someone to vomit it out. What Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam has said, and what in Arabic al-kabid it means clot also. Clot, the blood that is clotted. Yes, the Imam, because of the poison, he was vomiting the pieces of the clot, that is blood, not his liver. So that a youth sitting in our gathering says that this Sheikh doesn't know what he's talking about. How could Imam Masoom say that my liver is coming, you know, because I'm ignorant, because I haven't studied it properly. I didn't understand Imam Hassan Mujtaba, I misrepresent him. And therefore a youth sitting in the masjid, how come Imam Masoom says this, that is against science? Goes back to me. Imam Hassan was poisoned to death. Towards the end of his life, the last few hours of the life of Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam, send your souls as you are sitting here to Medina. Allahu Akbar. Imam Hassan was at the bosom of his younger brother and is giving his final will. And then Imam Hassan started crying. Imam Hussein alayhi salam says, brother, are you crying because of your orphan children? They are like my children. I look after them. Imam Hassan Mujtaba says, no brother, I'm crying because la yom kayomika ya Aba Abdullah. Because your day will be more severe than mine. And in fact, this happened. On Ashura it happened. This was one moment that Imam Hussein was hugging his older brother as Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam left this world. But another day also, imagine around the Furat when Abu al-Fazl al-Abbas cried for her. Ya Hussein, Adrik Akhak. Ya Hussein, Abu al-Fazl is also gone. Imam Hussein alayhi salam, they mentioned like a fighting falcon, rich brother Abu al-Fazl al-Abbas, the flag bearer of Imam Hussein, the commander of the army of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. But by the time he got there and he's hugging Abu al-Fazl, with all respect, I want to say Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam was not, his eyes were not shut. Imam Hassan Mujtaba alayhi salam, his arms were not severed. But which body Imam Hussein saw around the Quran, hugging Abu al-Fazl al-Abbas, who could not see the brother. Abu al-Fazl, who had no hands or arms in his body. That's why he stood up and says, Al-an, in kasara bahri, wa ghallat hilati nas'aluka Allahumma wa nad'uk, bismika al-azim al-a'zam, al-a'z al-ajal al-akram, ya Allah, ya Allah, ya Allah. It's the moment of the Qaza Hawa'ij, inshallah. Be conscious of your needs and also ask you to pray for them, especially the good reappearance of Imam al-Hujjah Jalallahu Farajhu Sharif. All the patient, inshallah, pray for the best and quick recovery. All those who have asked me, inshallah, the affairs of the Muslims around the globe, 5 times we recite Ayyi Sharifi Amman Yujib. A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim. أَمَّنْ يُجِيبُ الْمُضْطَرَّ إِذَا دَعَاهُ وَيَكْشِفُ السُّوءَ 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 بِجَاهِ مُحَمَّدٍ وَآلِ مُحَمَّدٍ وَبِحُرْمَةِ الْفَاتِحَةِ مَعَ الصَّلَوَاتِ.